Amelia Cafe is opening business.
Today, we talk about car suspension. Suspension is the system of tires, springs, shock absorbers and linkages that connects a vehicle to its wheels and allows relative motion between the two. A lot of forces are acting on suspension system, such as roll forces, squat forces, drive forces, road forces, steering forces, and G-forces. Usually suspension systems serve a dual purpose. One is contributing to the vehicle's road holding and braking for good active safety and driving pleasure. The other is keeping vehicle occupants comfortable and a ride quality reasonably well isolated from road noise, bumps, vibration, and so on. However, these two purposes are at odds. We should have a compromise. It is important for the suspension to keep the road wheel in contact with the road surface as much as possible, because all the road or ground forces acting on the vehicle do so through the contact patches of the tires. The suspension also protects the vehicle itself and any cargo or luggage from damage and wear. As we know, our cars have different drive type. The design of front and rear suspension of a car may be different. Obviously, any four-wheel vehicle needs suspension for both the front wheels and the rear suspension, but in two-wheel drive vehicles these can be very different configuration. Front-wheel drive cars, rear suspension has few constraints and a variety of beam axles and independent suspensions are used. Rear-wheel drive cars, rear suspension has many constraints and the development of the superior, but more expensive independent suspension layout has been difficult. Four-wheel drive often have suspensions that are similar for both the front and rear wheels. There are two types of suspension. Dependent suspension is with a beam, or driven lug axle that holds wheels parallel to each other and perpendicular to the axle. By contrast, independent suspension fulfills suspension with other devices. As one type of dependent suspension, Watt's linkage is designed by James Watt in 1784. The central moving point of the linkage is constrained to travel on an approximation to a straight line, allowing the axle of a vehicle to travel vertically while preventing sideways motion. Watt's linkage is used in the rear axle of some car suspensions. It is to prevent relative sideways motion between the axle and body of the car. It consists of two horizontal rods of equal length mounted at each side of the chassis. In between these two rods, a short vertical bar is connected. The center of this short vertical rod, the point which is constrained in a straight line motion, is mounted to the center of the axle. All pivoting points are free to rotate in a vertical plane.
I have a question. Spring and shock absorber, both, can absorb impacts separately. Why use both springs and shock absorbers? Now I see it. Springs absorb impacts. Shock absorbers to control spring motions in one direction. Shock absorbers also limited the stretch length of springs.
Let's go on. Watt's linkage is updated form Panhard bar. The roll center of these suspensions is the point around which the chassis rotates relative to the tires. The roll center describes how the cornering forces are divided up between the tires. Generally speaking, a lowering the rear roll center moves the chassis balance toward understeer, while raising the rear roll center moves the handling balance toward oversteer. However, the roll center height of a Watt's linkage is at the center pivot. The roll center height of a panhard bar rear suspension is located at the link's midpoint. As the rear axle moves, the rear roll center moves half as far. The panhard bar can be attached to the chassis on either the left or right side. In theory, the side of the chassis to which the panhard bar is attached can affect the way the car handles in left or right turns. By contrast, what's linkage's roll center moves in a perfectly vertical line relative to the chassis, that handling characteristics are identical in left or right corners. It provides more consistent handling behavior on road courses. Panhard bar is light and simple. If the panhard bar is long and remains roughly parallel to the ground, the differences in handling between a panhard bar and a Watts linkage can be minimized. Their disadvantages are, when the camber of one wheel changes, the camber of the opposite wheel changes in the same way. By convention, on one side this is a positive change in camber, and on the other side this a negative change. As one of independent suspension, sliding pillar is designed by Decoville in 1898. The stub axle and wheel assembly are attached to a vertical pillar, which slides up and down through a bush or bushes. Steering movement is provided by allowing this same sliding pillar to also rotate. Bushes are attached to the vehicle chassis, however, the track changes with differential suspension movement, such as when one wheel rises over an obstacle. Many types of suspension, such as the swing axle, have similar issues. Swing axle is another type of independent suspension, which is designed by Edmund Rumpler in 1903. It allows wheels to react to irregularities of road surfaces independently, and enable the vehicle to maintain a strong road holding. They traditionally use leaf springs and shock absorbers. But coil spring can also be used. Its advantage, eliminates sympathetic camber changes on opposite wheels. Reduce unsprung weight since the differential is mounted to the chassis. Its disadvantage, jacking on suspension unloading causes positive camber changes on both sides, which can overturn the car in extreme cases. Body roll, which makes both wheels lean towards the corner, thus result in severe overshear. Reduction in cornering forces due to change in camber can lead to overshear at dynamically unstable condition, where a vehicle can lose control and spin, and in extreme cases lift off oversteer by using two instead of only one. We get double wishbone. It is designed by Citroën in 1934. It allows the engineer to carefully control the motion of the wheel throughout suspension travel, controlling such parameters as camber angle, caster angle, toe pattern, roll center height, scrub radius, scuff, and more. A double wishbone or upper and lower arm use, two wishbone-shaped arms to locate the wheel. Each wishbone has two mounting points to the chassis and one joint at the knuckle. The shock absorber and coil spring mount to the wishbones to control vertical movement. It can be used in front and rear. It has near-perfect camber control. It is the first choice for racing cars, sports cars and demanding sedans. Let's have a detailed view from front, plan and side. Don't miss. When used in front, it needs a steering gear tie rod. Double wishbone is fairly easy to work out the effect of moving each joint, so the kinematics of the suspension can be tuned easily and wheel motion can be optimized. It is also easy to work out the loads that different parts will be subjected to, which allows more optimized lightweight parts to be designed. They also provide increasing negative camber gain all the way to full jounce travel. However, it may take more space and is slightly more complex than other. Due to the increased number of components within the suspension setup, it takes much longer to service and is heavier. Okay, while swing axle and double wishbone's arms are transverse, another type of independent suspension trailing arm are trailing. trailing arm suspension employs two trailing arms, which are pivoted to the car body at the arm's front edge. The arm is relatively large compared with other suspension's control arms, because it is in single piece and the upper surface supports the coil spring. It is rigidly fixed to the wheel at the other end. It only allows the wheel to move up and down to deal with bump. Any lateral movement and camber change with respect to the car body is not allowed. Seen from the side, this arm is roughly parallel to the ground, with the angle changing based on road irregularities. Nevertheless, when the car rolls into a corner, the trailing arm rolls for the same degree as the car body, thus changes camber angle with respect to the road surface. Both wheels lean towards the outside of the corner, thus lead to understeer. Semi-trailing arm suspension has the trailing arm pivoted at inclined angles about 50 to 70 degrees. Apparently, the semi-trailing arms are half trailing and half transverse. We can analyze it by splitting it into two vectors. One is the trailing component and another is the transverse component. The trailing component leads to understeer. On the other hand, the transverse component is actually equals to a swing axle suspension which always introduce oversteer due to body roll. As a result, the two components cancel each other and result in near neutral steering response. Trailing arm and multilink suspension designs are much more commonly used for the rear wheels of a vehicle where they can allow for a flatter floor and more cargo room. Semi-trailing has a disadvantage. When the wheel moves up and down, camber angle changes, unlike double wishbone suspension. No matter semi-trailing arm or pure trailing arm suspensions, since they are rigidly attached to the wheels, inevitably more shock and noise could be transferred to the car body, especially under hard cornering or running on bumpy roads. Moreover, a lot of unsprung weight of the trailing arm leads to poor ride quality. Macpherson Strut is devised by Earl S. Macpherson in 1937. Use a wishbone, or a substantial compression link stabilized by a secondary link, which provides a bottom mounting point for the hub carrier or axle of the wheel. Lower arm system provides both lateral and longitudinal location of the wheel. Upper part of the hub carrier is rigidly fixed to the bottom of the outer part of the strut proper. It slides up and down the inner part of it, which extends upwards directly to a mounting in the body shell of the vehicle. The line from the strut's top mount to the bottom ball joint on the control arm gives the steering axis inclination. The strut's axis may be angled inwards from the steering axis at the bottom to clear the tire. This makes the bottom follow and arc when steering. Let us also view Macpherson strut both from front and side. Both parts provide lateral and longitudinal locating while still permitting vertical movement. There is also a steering gear tie rod. Macpherson strut is simple and relatively low cost. A few disadvantages in the quality of ride and the handling of the car. Geometric analysis shows it cannot allow vertical movement of the wheel without some degree of either camber angle change, sideways movement, or both. Multi-link suspension using three or more lateral arms and one or more longitudinal arms. These arms do not have to be of equal length and may be angled away from their obvious direction. Typically each arm has a spherical joint, ball joint, or rubber bushing at each end. Consequently, they react to loads along their own length, in tension and compression, but not in bending. On a front suspension, one of the lateral arms is replaced by the tie rod, which connects the rack or steering box to the wheel hub. Let's recall double wishbone suspension. Now let's view multi-link suspension. Multi-link arrangements are used on both the front and the rear suspensions, but the former replaces a lateral arm with a tie rod that connects the rack or steering box to the wheel hub. Its advantage is that, It offers the best compromises between handling and space efficiency and comfort in handling. Allows a vehicle to flex more, it's also a very good solution for off-road driving. Can alter one parameter in the suspension without influencing the entire assembly. This is a major difference compared to a double wishbone suspension. But it is costly and complex to design and manufacture. The suspension's geometry needs to be checked with design analysis software. Oh, now we give the suspension summary. It is a list which includes position, orientation, advantage and disadvantage for the suspension. You can download the brochure in our website.
Thank you for watching this episode. Welcome to Camellia Cafe. More interesting products and learnings, please visit www.camellia.xin. Your precious ideas will improve our products and service greatly.